Welcome to the Good Bad Mad Podcast, a show that's here to share the ins and outs of creative careers, connecting the aspirational with the experienced, with your host, me, Meg Ellis. Our guest for this episode is Anna Fleischle, an Olivier-Award winning stage and costume designer for theatre, opera and dance. She's designed for Everybody's Talking About Jamie, Home I'm Darling and many, many more. She is also heavily involved in the movement Scene Change, which we shall discuss today along with what it takes to be a designer. Enjoy. Thank you so much for agreeing to be a part of this and allowing us into your lovely studio. So here on the Good Bad Mad, we're all about learning the ins and outs of creative professionals and their careers. So should we start at the very beginning? And for those who are just gleaming insight into what the theatre industry is, what does a stage designer do?
A lot. So I, whenever someone asks me that, you think, God, that's going to be a long answer.
Yeah.
But and I do set, so stage and costume, which is quite common in this country, not so common other countries. Like in the States, you usually, do one or the other. Obviously, you're kind of, everything that you see on stage, whether it is, you know, the kind of the set, the background, the furniture, the clothes, whatever, everything visual like that would have been designed by the designer and overseen the kind of, so you design it, you oversee the making of it, you know, you work with the actors in the costume, you work with many different departments on the set side. But I think what I find really exciting about the job, and I think quite often people don't realize as part of it, is that you're actually the first one to start working on a project because of the because of the timeline, how long it takes to make things and to cost things. So I quite often start several months before anyone else starts, which means that actually as a designer you're very heavily involved in coming up with a concept, with an idea for a show, you know, with how you're going to approach it. What's the style? What's the kind of vision of it? Is it period? Do you keep it in period? Do you not keep it in period? They're all decisions that, ideas that designers come up with very often. And obviously decisions are made with the director. You share with the director. It can vary. Sometimes the director might have an idea already and then you work along that. And sometimes you might start totally on your own and you present your ideas to director, and if they like it, they run with it.
Right.
So that, in a way, is the kind of the birth of it all, and the biggest part of it, because it very much all rests on your shoulders.
Well, I guess so.
And and then, you know, your design process is very exciting. I really like it, and it's very much you being on your own in your studio. You know, drawing, researching. You make a model, 1 to 25 model for set, so a miniature of what it's meant to be. So you
make out of wood,
different materials. You know, a lot of card, but then at the moment we use, I use a lot of laser cutting because that's more precise. Obviously, 3D printing has come in, and so you need to make everything that needs to be made and in a kind of miniature 3D version.
Okay.
Which is really, really useful. I mean, it's useful for us, I think, to see things three-dimensional. A lot of directors are not very good at kind of envisaging things from the 2D, so they understand it better if it's 3D, because it's spatial, obviously. You can kind of move things around. You understand the kind of distance between things. But then I always find that building a really good model helps me a lot later, because if you have a very good model and you take that to the workshop, which will be building things, you have a lot less work in having to explain what exactly it is that you want. So there's there's less room for error. And so you do, this is what you do on the set side. You also need to make technical drawings. So everything, you know, like in similar to architects, I guess. And on the costume side, obviously, it's a kind of kind of thing about, you know, drawing, developing those things. And then you supervise the making of it.
Right. So when you're starting out, possibly even before the director's come on board, you've read the play.
Yes.
And you've kind of got these ideas starting to go around in your head about possibilities of what it would look like. And then do you draft something up before
And present it to the director before doing all the model making?
Yes, yeah. And I mean, it varies. I'm sure that every designer's got a different way of doing it. I feel that most of the time, I couldn't even tell you, I was doing the same thing every time. So it depends a little bit what the story is. And, you know, the first read is really important to me, and I really need to have enough space for it and let it kind of just live in my head for a bit. And then I kind of usually really try in my head to break up what I think the story is and what is at the core of it. What's the bit that I think I want to tell that might sometimes not be the obvious story, you know, it might be an underlying thing, or what's the underlying emotion, or and then I will sometimes first just talk with the director, just chat and we share those thoughts. Then I do a lot of research, visual research. And again, that sometimes can be very one-to-one and practical, as in it's set in a pub somewhere, and research pubs, but it can also be quite open and random, you know.
I guess it depends if you're doing naturalism or you're going for something more abstract.
Yes, but sometimes, you know, you find things, like when I did Death of a Salesman recently, the first thing I did is try and find images that for me represent what it feels like when you have certain mental conditions. What would it feel like if you're really disorientated, or the world, you can't bring the outside world together with the world in your head? You know, what visualizes that sensation, that kind of emotional state? And so it doesn't, that could be a landscape or a portrait or an abstract piece of art. So it's kind of finding these things, and then in that journey I sometimes all of a sudden find the thing where I go, like, that's really interesting, you know, maybe it's all about kind of harsh lights or angles, or, you know, so quite often my journey into it is like that. So it's more abstract than necessarily having to do with the locations, but again, the way how you might later portray it, to me anyway, is all part of that journey. So I'm sure if you kind of look through my work, you couldn't say, oh, she was does naturalistic stuff, or it's always abstract or whatever, because I don't think in theatre that's the answer. It's, you know, it's about expressing each piece individually, and the answer to that, you know.
So those themes within the text are really quite crucial to
your process. They're really crucial, yeah. And sometimes, like, you know, I've worked with Martin McDonagh a few times, and his text, a kind of interesting juxtaposition, and a lot of the humour happens because of that juxtaposition.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? If you then abstract it, it's actually not, you know...
It wouldn't quite work the same way.
Yes, I think so. It wouldn't support it in the same way.
So that, going through the text at the beginning, that's a really crucial part. You're taking things out part by part, and then you come up with your... I guess initial design concept.
Yes, and so the first thing I do is a concept folder, usually, as in it's purely just images, so I call it concept research, and then that would be the first thing I share with the director, talking about how I think that might possibly transfer into something physical.
Right, and so that will have some sketches, maybe a colour palette, that kind of thing?
Yeah, mood boards, yeah, that kind of thing. And then my next step would be, sometimes I make a rough model that is really rough, as in I just use old bits of model boxes or whatever, just kind of shapes, you know. And then the first official step in the process of making a set design is called a white card model. And all the white card stands for really is that it's a model that is quite close already to what you want the set to be, but it doesn't necessarily have finishes on it.
Okay.
So, you know, it doesn't have to be, you know, the floor doesn't have to be looking like wood or whatever. Sometimes that isn't made out of white card. Sometimes it lends itself better to make it out of black card.
Yeah.
But it's plain. It's more about shapes and functionality, not yet about detail.
I guess you have to think about the practicalities as well, as like, where are the actors going to be entering the stage, exiting the stage,
all of that, and how do they enter, exit? You know, sometimes the energy of how you want people to come on will determine why you, for example, have, you know, in Hangman, I had a kind of double swing door,
right?
And that was all about, you know, in the text, it feels like the people from the outside world that just kind of like bolt in, you know.
Very
and the
dramatic.
Interesting thing is, like, whoa, you know, there's this kind of there's a newcomer,
yeah,
you know, and you need that newcomer to be quite sudden and a bit. And we actually, in the original set door, had a creak in it, and the sound designer ended up recording it, and that became quite a big thing of it, that there's always that creak of the door when they come in. So they're all things that you consider, how people come in, go off, how many there are, what the scene changes are like, you know, if something is moving, how can it move and who moves it. And obviously at that point I would have already had to really study the theatre, the possibilities of that theatre. Can you fly things, you know, how wide is the side, you know, this are the wings, you know, how deep is the backstage, has it got traps in the floor, can you bring something up from below. They're all things, you know, they're all kind of specifications that you need to learn, find out. Also, you obviously have been given a budget, so, you know, and that kind of gets easier with experience to kind of have a bit of a kind of understanding of whether you're roughly.
Is it quite tricky? I mean, if you go into something and you have all these amazing grand ideas, and then suddenly the budget doesn't allow it, and you have to shrink them. Is that quite?
It's really difficult. I think shrinking and cutting is a very creative and unproductive thing. So I believe in really knowing what my budget is and trying to stay within it, and also checking early. So I check quite early with production managers and you know, anyone who can give me more knowledge on, because even if, like, after a white card, so when you've done a white card, you present that to with the director, to the company, and the technical staff will be there, so whether it's a production manager or the technical director of the theatre.
Right.
And you also get to meet, or usually try to meet, a few set builders that can then quote for it. So the idea for that is that before you finish everything off, you get a little bit of an idea where you are at financially.
Okay.
And also sometimes they will introduce, so the different set builders might introduce different ideas, as in, I want this massive sliding piece, and one of them goes, that has to be totally automatic, you know, and that will cost you so and so much in machinery, and someone else will have maybe a different solution.
Yeah.
And then I can feel I can still cut quite easily, because I'm still in a creative process.
Yeah.
So again, I try to really, unless the idea is really brilliant as it is and you can't cut it, I do try and get it into the right place. Because once you've finished it, so the last step would be to make a final model, which is with everything in it, every different scene, everything has to be fully there. If you then have to cut after that, that's really tricky and just not a very creative process, because that literally is take this out, take that
problem
out, can't have that, which leaves you with something that feels quite, sometimes you can be lucky and it looks okay, and sometimes it feels like something that has literally been ripped apart, doesn't, you know, it doesn't make sense anymore. Some theatres with big workshops like planning early and might want to have costume designs a month or so before rehearsals start. But I have to say, most of the time nowadays, especially the way the directors work, is it's not really feasible anymore, because people want to find out things, try things out, do you know what I mean? And so...
Right. They like to have as much time as possible.
Yeah, it's easier with period, because, you know, it is what it is and it's set, and then it's more that the production and the actors have to grow into it.
Yeah.
If it's modern day, it's slightly different, because you want people to first kind of find themselves and their characters, and you don't want the costume to jar with who they are.
So I guess the two roles of set designer and costume designer do fit really quite hand in hand. Like, you come up with the concept, the design, and then they kind of play off one another.
They do. And I mean, their form, for me, in my head, it always is this thing that they form one vision. So, and that, I guess that is why I like doing both. It has to be said though that it is, I mean, it's huge. And depending on the show, it's even bigger. And costume is very, very time consuming. So costume always is a little bit like the stepchild, doesn't get much attention, gets far too little money. I mean, all of it gets a little money, but costume really badly. Whilst it's actually the far more time-consuming and more stressful job, because also you're dealing with a lot of individuals, lots of human beings that you go in, you know, every fitting with each actor is like you have to totally kind of engage in them, you know, communicate, make them happy, you know, it's exhausting, absolutely exhausting.
I guess for a show like everybody's talking about Jamie, for instance, like the costume in that is crucial to the character and the storyline as a whole. You know, it's like, did the set almost take a little back seat in that production?
later on, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, a good thing is that it is that staggered sometimes. Mm-hmm. So the set takes the kind of, the first lot of your time, whilst you're not that involved in costumes mm-hmm. yet. And with Jamie, it was very much about kind of going along as they were rehearsing, as they were, because it was a new piece as well. Yeah. So finding the character is not just an actor finding his version of that character. Yeah. It's actually creating the character.
It is. You're actually incredibly involved in the creative process as a whole, rather than just like your section almost.
Yeah absolutely. And I mean, definitely later it took center stage, and you know, for a show of that size, we obviously did it in Sheffield on a smaller budget, small budget first, and that was kind of pretty full on. And then, you know, for the rest on it was much more full on. And I mean, generally, time-wise, if you look at it, it's crazy to do both.
Yeah.
It really is. I mean, you know, it's not healthy. Let's put it like that.
I guess this is maybe an element we can come on to later, is the whole, how do you balance it between that, life, freelancing, all of that. But for now, we're hitting the rehearsal period.
Yes.
So are you going to rehearsals? Are you back here in your studio? What's your kind of role at that stage?
So this is kind of, in a way, the interesting thing about being a designer and that I kind of love, is that I have this period where I'm mainly here. And I mean, I do have assistants and, you know, so it's not always just me on my own. But it's very kind of intense and kind of quiet and concentrated. Mm. And then as soon as you go into rehearsals, it's a totally different thing. Then it's like masses of people, super busy. I mean, you have to like that, you know, so you have to like both in a way and be okay with both. But you definitely, in the first day of rehearsals, you would present the design to the entire company. And so there'll be a model showing. You go through the costume designs with the cast. And then usually there's a read through. So that's a really lovely, lovely day when everyone gets
quite nerve wracking, I imagine.
Yeah.
Presenting your like personal creative work to all these people and go,
I mean, I love it. I know that some designers don't like it, because it also depends what kind of person you are. You know, a designer does not have to be someone who likes kind of standing in front of a lot of people speaking, because most of it is very kind of, you know, it's backstage, it's behind the curtain,
insular work.
I don't mind it, you know. I really quite like kind of, you know, it's nice that moment where you can go like, okay, this is my bit, and now I need you all on board. Do you know what I mean? And then it depends off how much you're in rehearsals. It depends on the relationship with the director. It depends on what kind of process it is. To be honest, in this country, we don't get paid enough really as designers to be in rehearsal all the time. So sometimes directors here go, but in Germany, everyone, you know, designers are always there. Why are you not there? And you go, well, they get paid
well.
You know, so I have to really overlap in order to make ends meet. You cannot just work on one show. So the rehearsal time of one show will be the preparation time for another one.
I see.
So you will have, you, that's where some, quite a lot of the stress comes from. And so you have, so you're dipping in and out, but there's a production meeting once a week in the rehearsal room, but that you would definitely go to. I would obviously now also start set builder visits, which could be anywhere in the country.
Right.
I would go to the prop supervisors to kind of look at what furniture they've found, and then costume starts, and that will be a lot of meeting with this costume supervisor who will do all the fabric sampling or you know, all of those meetings. And then maybe 2 or 3 weeks into rehearsals, you start with fittings.
Right.
And depending on how big that the show is, you know, that can be easily 3-4 days a week.
Goodness, it takes forever. Yeah,
it takes forever. And that takes you through the second phase, which is that, you know, you were kind of all over the place running. Yeah. And obviously the interesting thing with design as well is, so from the time when you're in your studio and you're trying to imagine all of it together, you would not ever have had that vision again. Everything gets pulled into different places. So it's one of the trickiest things is, as things are developing, for you to keep the overall vision. Because one thing is made here, the other thing is made there. This costume is made by this person. That costume is dyed over here. Whatever. I never get to see anything together at all. It's all over the place. And then it's only when you go into the theatre and the period that's called the technical rehearsals, and you go on stage, that everything comes together. So the set will be built, and I can see that obviously before the actors come, you know, over a week or whatever, that is, it's being built. And but then I won't be able to see it in the theatrical lighting until you start tech, and that will be a massive change again. So it's quite a lot of the last paint calls, in order to finish things off, we try and schedule quite a way into tech, because I can't judge sometimes what I want or what the best thing is until I've seen it in the right lighting.
Well, I guess, I mean, so when you're first designing it, you really have to think about what kind of lighting.
Oh yeah,
as well.
I always do. I'm always really clear on what, and I always meet with a lighting designer really early on, so that they're very kind of aware of the kind of, you know, the feel that I want. Sometimes, quite often, like in Jamie, a lot of the lighting is built in, so you know, some of the elements, like you know, the ceiling lights up and the desks light up. So some of those elements are actually in continuous collaboration.
Mm.
Yeah, and the same with costume. You won't have seen costume together.
Mm.
And so that's, very intense.
Is there a large
very
element of just that tech week just going, please work, please
oh,
work,
God,
please
I
work?
Know. And then obviously anything that needs to then be changed is very complicated because, you know, you can't, for example, if a costume needs a massive alteration, you can't do that until the actor's out of it.
Right.
And then it has to be done really quickly.
So I'm guessing lots of late nights.
Yeah, God. I mean,
tech
goes until 11 anyway.
Yeah.
And as a designer, so if you look at time scales and you go, oh, God, that's tough. You know, people have to be in from 10 and we finish at 10. A designer would be there an hour and a half before and leave an hour and a half later. And you are obviously, you're meant to be in the room, or you want to be in the room all the time because things are happening. Whilst a lot of people need your answers. So literally the minute the break starts, I'm off, off from one department to the next. So you eat your food whilst you sit in the theatre and in a tech, because the breaks are the busiest bits for a designer, usually.
So I guess just lots of thinking on your feet.
Yes.
Problem solving, all of that.
Yeah.
So you've survived tech week, you've survived press night, opening night. Is that when you take a big deep breath of relief?
You still have previews as well, which we're getting, because the tech, they kept squashing tech, as in you're not actually quite finished by the first time the audience comes into the room. So actually the previews can, you know, I mean,
you're still making tweaks throughout previews.
Oh my God, I mean, more than tweaks. Sometimes quite big decisions.
What's the biggest one
I mean, I've definitely taken whole things away during a tech. Let me just think, which one was it that I changed? Anyway, sometimes there can be really big changes.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had shows where I did a show, I'm not going to name it, where I came in just as on the night before our first tech day, and there was a whole massive element on the floor that had been made totally wrong, far too big. They wouldn't have been able to rehearse on it. So they took the entire element, which affected a lot of other things that were happening in a set away, to remake, and we only got it back about 2 hours before the public performance.
Oh my goodness.
And so nobody had worked with it. We hadn't finished lighting it. Mm. I mean, the director had to come in the beginning and say, you know, it'll only be lit until this point. And then we finished it off in tiny little sessions in between performances. And that is painful.
Oh my goodness.
That's
I guess
not
that's
nice.
Theatre for you.
I know. So, yes, I think the audience always seems to love it when there's something not finished.
You know what,
but for us, it's really
awful.
People
love the behind the scenes stuff.
They
love
do.
To go, oh, I yeah. little insight into how that's made,
I know, but it's really not nice to have to, you know, show something to a great number of people that you are not happy
with.
Well,
I guess you're putting your name on it, aren't
you?
You
do, yeah. So it's very personal,
actually.
I've forgotten what your original question was. Oh, press night, you said.
Yeah.
I mean, there is usually a big, of course, that's a massive relief.
Yeah.
And then I guess the one thing that is quite good about having shows overlapping is because obviously the thing is, like, you know, with press night, it is like doing your A-levels.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You spend a lot of time hyping, going, you know, and then boom, it's gone.
Yeah.
And, you know, so to keep your mental health going through those things and not have a massive dip is quite a difficult thing. Because there's a lot of the kind of creative team, we're done on press night. This is it. This is us done, gone, you know. And so it's quite a sudden and abrupt.
It is.
Kind
I guess it's the same with actors as well. Once the show ends, you go from this huge period of being close with a huge number of people. You get to know people incredibly quickly.
Yeah, you become like a family.
You do. So it's a very intense experience. And then suddenly show ends, press night happens for you guys.
That's it.
Nothing.
Gone. I know. Yeah.
It is quite a almost like retching experience.
It is, you just definitely
kind of set apart. Yeah. But no, I definitely see where you're coming from. Just like, keep it up.
Keep the level going. So having a couple of meetings a few days after is definitely it's a good thing.
So do you find yourself getting quite emotionally invested in a lot of the work you do?
Yeah, very. It is a bit like, it is a little bit like having a child. It's a kind of, you know, because you live towards it, you live towards it. I think if you don't invest yourself emotionally in it, I think you're in the wrong
industry.
Job. Yes, yeah. Yeah. And the kind of like when it's finished, it is like giving it away. Do you know what I mean? And obviously it depends. Some things you're more emotionally invested in than others. Sometimes it's because of the process. Sometimes it's because of the story.
Yeah.
And the story can touch you more maybe when it's very personal, as in, you know, comes close to something you've experienced. Or it can touch you when it's something you've never been that close to before. Mm. And you become incredibly close to it. I did a show at the Royal Court called Liberian Girl, which was about child soldiers, and I mean it was probably one of the hardest things I've ever worked on. Really? You know, the research already, but just really getting into that is, you know, it's a proper emotional investment, because you have to fully give yourself to that, but it's like a mini trauma you get from it. Yes, because you know they are traumatic things, and you obviously feel for their characters and you feel for the stories you're reading for your research, and it really felt like, you know, something like that, it feels like you need to give yourself some time afterwards to get over it.
Well, I bet you've got this pressure on yourself to almost do the story justice and do these people, if it's based on true events, you've got to.
Yes, I had a post-show talk with that show, and in the front row of the audience were two people who I thought they're from Liberia. And I was really, you know, and you kind of feel like exactly that. Mm. And just the whole time I thought, like, I really hope that I've done this justice. I really hope that you're not upset with me. You know, I did try and give it everything.
Yeah.
And they raised their hand at one point and said how moved they were and how much the space felt like Liberia or whatever. And that was the biggest compliment I've ever had in my career.
That must have been lovely.
You know, for them to really feel that I had really tried to, you know, give it justice, and they felt that I had. So, yes, that.
Do you have a preference when it comes to kind of, I guess, signing on to do a show? Like, do you prefer new work or work that's been around for hundreds of years, or pieces?
I think one of the reasons why I'm in theatre is because I love the mix.
Yeah.
And I love the challenges. I also really feel that you know, the world is so full of different stories and so full of kind of contradictions and, you know, different. I mean, one of the reasons why I wanted to live in a different country to where I've born is because I think it's important for us to experience the other side.
Yeah.
And so I feel that's what I do with the different shows, is that it's you experience different sides all the time. And I think in order to be, I think, hopefully a person who will never get stuck and never kind of feel like I've just got one vision, or I get very set in my ways, which is something I'm kind of hoping never to be. You need to keep shifting all the time. So I couldn't say that I prefer one or the other, actually. I mean, I do love new writing. I love the idea of doing something for the first time. But I also love reinventing things. And I also, even though it's the most stressful thing to do, but I have worked quite a bit with people who do more divisive work, you know, whether it's Lloyd Newsom from DV8 or Simon McBurney, you know, where you where you might not know what it is until literally the day you open.
Well, I bet it's completely different. It's
totally different. And you have to stay very kind of just, you know, relaxed and with it.
Trust but the
that's
process.
That's a journey. That's not a finished story. That's a journey, and you don't actually know where it's going to end.
Yeah.
Which is equally exciting. So,
Have you ever felt yourself almost being pushed towards one genre, like almost pigeonholed, and you've gone actively, no, I'm not going to do that?
Yeah, not so much, luckily.
That's good.
I never made myself, maybe not consciously, unconsciously, part of a group, like part of the people who always work at a national, or always do this, or always do that, because I guess as a migrant, I quite like being the migrant. Yeah. I don't want to home in anywhere.
Well, that's the thing, you get to experience more.
I'm very happy sitting, you know, by the, not sitting by the side. I just think, you know, stay a traveller.
So let's talk about that. So you were born in Munich.
Munich, yeah.
And what made you decide to come over here to train?
I mean, a few different things, mm-hmm. I guess. I mean, I always kind of thought, I was always interested in England, and I came here when I was 16. I really wanted to go on exchange, so, mm-hmm. you know, it was all arranged, and I came here, and I really loved it. It was just outside London, mm-hmm. and I really fell in love with London, with the diversity and the openness, and...
But was that quite different to Munich at the time?
Very different to Munich at the time. Mm. I think, you know, Germany's changed a lot in the last 25 years, but it wasn't diverse when I grew up, just because there isn't that tradition, you know, there wasn't the same kind of colonial tradition, I guess. But I think also, you know, having grown up in Germany in the time that I did, which was still kind of I grew up very conscious of the kind of the country's guilt and the country's past, and how you felt as a kind of descendant, like it was something that you needed to carry.
Really? There was that huge pressure on your generation.
Massive pressure, yeah. And I think, I think the reason why I needed to go somewhere else is kind of, you know, it's got a few different strands to it. I know that I needed to free myself from that, because you, as much as I really believe in knowing your history, and I believe that, you know, if we were better at remembering our general human history, we would be better at the now and the future.
This is future generations end up holding the guilt of past generations, which personally I believe should not happen.
No, you shouldn't hold the guilt, and I think that's where the difference is. I do think you should be conscious 100%. Of what happened, but the thing is that a guilt that is passed on to you is totally suffocating, because you can't do anything about it, because it's not your guilt.
I'm almost shocked that to hear you say that. Like, I wouldn't expect someone of your generation to feel that.
Pressure. Totally. But then, to be honest, coming to England, there was still a lot of, I've still definitely had many conversations where that was thrown at me. So it's not like, or kind of if someone ran out of arguments, there was a lot of, but we won the war, which is good. Can't believe like,
cheers for that.
No, it was also so ludicrous, but anyway.
Oh, you poor thing.
But then also I think because of that, and because of kind of what happened in Germany, in the kind of like inward looking and the nationalism and the, you know, and the what happens when people feel frightened and scared by the outside and the other, I really felt like I can't let my life be about that. I want to explore other cultures, and I want to live somewhere else. I want to take myself out of that in order to learn to really live somewhere else, experience that culture, and therefore be able to look back onto where I come from with that physical distance. And I've never regretted that. I've always really
So this was you at 16?
This was me at 16.
I mean, that's astonishing, just insight for a 16-year-old to begin with. But that's a very impressive decision.
Yeah, it was
just
quite.
To go, quite I don't full on. Like where I'm at.
Yeah.
Like in society or personally, in going to seek something else.
Yeah. I mean, it's very conscious. I know I kind of now look back and think, you know, think similarly, like, wow, it was quite intense. But maybe because I did feel so strongly about, you know, those things. And I really, and kind of living in London, and I've now worked in many, many different places, and I always. So far, anyway, come back to London, and when people say, oh, you've got kids now, do you want to move to the countryside? My thing always is that London is the most diverse and most open place I know in the world that I've been to, and that is where I want my children to grow up.
I want them
to experience that, and I want that to be the kind of foundation of who they are. Yeah.
So you came over here and you studied stage design?
Yeah, I came over, so after my exchange, went back just at my A-levels, was like, this is after my A-levels, I'm going. And so that was always clear. And then I came back, I applied for a foundation at Central St. Martin's, and so I did a foundation, and then...
Central St. Martin's, that's kind of the artsy school, isn't it? Like, I guess so. I know there's a lot of fashion.
I think on the fashion level, yes. I think there's a couple of kind of, you know, strands that St. Martin's very famous for.
But you enjoyed that program?
I definitely enjoyed the foundation. I think that was brilliant. And the interesting thing was that up until the foundation, even though I'd done quite a lot of theatre at school, and I always loved it. But somehow I don't think at that point I was thinking I was going to go into theatre. I knew I didn't want to be an actor. Mm-hmm. And I've always loved drawing, painting, all of that. And I started making my own clothes when I was a teenager.
Something your family passed down to you? Not at all, really.
Apparently my grandma, but I never met her. All through my kind of, I think I was really young when I started making my own clothes, so I loved all that.
Yeah.
And I loved kind of interior design, all of these things. So it's like, wow, give it to me, you know, foundation was amazing.
Well, your parents and just like, where did this child come from?
A little bit, yeah. I mean, my mum still says that now. Yeah. It's like, I don't understand. Yeah, and then I remember when we had like a few days on theatre design within the foundation, and it was literally like, you know, just a revelation. It was just like, that is it. That is totally
it. Big spark moment.
Yes, I can marry all of these things together. And I love stories. I love imagining worlds, do you mean? And I also knew that I wasn't the kind of artist who would just be in their studio, come up with their own things, work on their own, create stuff. I'm very much a people's person as well. I love being with other people. Yeah. And I love for the impulse to be something that's just something. It can just be a piece of music, I don't mind, but I like the impulse. And I also I do work better on a deadline.
Yeah. Don't worry, we all do. Night before.
I know. I need the pressure. Yeah.
So you studied there, and did that teach you pretty much everything you needed to know, or was the practical lessons the real lesson?
I think it was good on a kind of like, you know, free creative level. I think on a technical level, I came out knowing very little. Mm-hmm. So I think I was lucky because my brother's ex-wife is a set and costume designer.
Okay.
So she was always, and she's quite a few years older than me, so she kind of took me a bit under her wings. So I went to Germany quite a bit and assisted her and kind of got my first jobs in Germany through that. And she was always someone I could ask questions, so that was really
good. So you had that mental figure, which was
I'm very thankful for that. And then in Germany, I very quickly, so I kind of, even though I studied here and I didn't want to move back, because of that connection, ended up all of a sudden working in Germany all the time. And I quite quickly did quite big things. And that was really, really stressful because I was definitely blagging my way through it.
A bit of imposter syndrome.
Oh, my God. And there's just so much you need to know. So I don't recommend that. Yeah. I wish it hadn't been like that. And then I really went like, why am I doing this? I'm living here. I do not want to move back to Germany. I'm working there all the time. So I very consciously moved things back here. But at the time, people in England, just whenever I showed my portfolio, everything I'd done outside England, they just turned it as if it was blank pages. Absolutely no kind of, if I don't know where it is, then it doesn't exist kind
really,
of attitude.
Really, they were that close-minded?
Oh my God, yeah. Oh. So I kind of started in pub theatres again, which was quite tough after having done like big ballets and stuff. And
that must have been.
So it's like a double start, yeah.
Yeah. But I guess kind of making that transition very quickly in Germany, you actually, I guess, seeing the benefits of the situation, you may have had more time starting
more experience
again.
And to be honest, I financed being able to start here by shows I was doing in Germany. So I would literally, you know, because I couldn't have worked my way up here financially, I wouldn't have been able to. And so by doing some shows in Germany, earning some money, I was able to kind of start here with the payment you get on the fringe.
What do you think it was? They just were anti-Europe, or it was a different style of show?
I think it's changed massively since then, I have to say. But at the time, I definitely, when I first moved to England, it was so much an island. You know, having come from Munich, which is, you know, at the kind of cusp of many other countries.
Yes.
You know, you go and sit on a train in Munich, and within 2 hours you can be in five different countries.
No, it's much more sociable.
So what was going on in these countries was always like, you know, nearly like, you know, in your own place. Mm. You know, you would go to Austria, for example, and see a show.
Right.
Absolutely, you do that. You go to France and see something. So there's a different consciousness about, you know, we would know so-and-so, a director who does right. something in France. Or you kind of, now people know here, but yeah. at the time it was very much like, this is what we do and we don't understand.
So it was like the theatre industry of Europe versus
yes.
the British theatre yeah, industry.
Insular.
They were very
yes.
separate entities.
Very insular here, yes.
So was that quite tough then, really,
yeah, really.
Starting again? And
yes.
How long did it kind of take you to kind of, I guess, let's say, transition from off West End to bigger productions?
I mean, I can't give you years, but many years.
Yeah.
And then I guess the next problem I had was having children.
Well,
and that was
yes.
met very, I mean, within my kind of industry and community, whatever, it was like, well, that's you done then, isn't it?
Really? You
yeah.
felt that complete
yeah,
barrier shut
absolutely,
down?
Absolutely, completely, no question. And I didn't do a kind of bigger show for the first 7 years after I had my daughter.
Right.
And so kind of now people, I know that now people look at, you know, someone like me and go, wow, you know, she's kind of doing all this stuff and she's had a good career. And I was 43 when I had my actual breakthrough.
Right.
So, you know.
It took time.
I know. So it's not fallen into, you know.
Yeah.
But I have to say, I mean, I'm part of, I'm an ambassador for PIPA, Parents and Carers and Performing Arts,
mm-hmm.
because I do think that's a massive thing that has to change. I wouldn't wish
yeah.
that attitude that I was met with on anyone. And I think things are changing. So that bit was really difficult and not good. I think...
So
working your way up is not a terrible thing. I do think it's important to learn.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
And I mean, personally, I just think it's important to meet as many people as you possibly
yes.
can.
Learn everything
you can from as many people. It's not necessarily about paying your dues, as people always say, but
yes.
you need to network. You need,
yeah.
like,
you do.
You need to be inspired by other people.
Yeah, and it's absolutely. But also, I think it's a career where, you know, I know that there can be a little bit the attitude of, like, you know, I've got ideas and I immediately need to do big things, whatever. But, you know, you have to learn your trade, and you have to, you know, those kind of professions are about building up a reputation, about building up your way of expressing, and that isn't done over two years. That is something that, so you know, when there's a kind of envy of people who have a certain place, only very few people who through some kind of lucky incidences very quickly did really big
yeah.
things. They're the minority. Everything else is really stamina, and it's kind of craftsmanship and talent, and I think in that kind of I know, society that we live in now, where we think like it all has to be instant,
culture.
You know, it's just, it's not like that. You do have to, this is why I think if you want to go into theatre in general, you have to have the stamina, and you have to, but I think it's thrilling. I think it's brilliant. Mm. It is not just a negative thing.
No.
Do you know what I mean? I really value all the different experiences that I've made.
Well, I think, as far as I'm concerned, the quicker you reach something, the quicker you leave it.
I know. And what are you going to do after
exactly.
that?
Exactly. Like, because you haven't had time to build the appreciation for it, or the enjoyment, or the kind of the wins and the fails and the
yes.
all of that, you haven't experienced the journey, therefore you can't enjoy it
no.
as much. You know?
And I mean, the kind of one of the best things about being, I guess, where I'm now, what I'm really enjoying is the experience.
Mm.
I really, it's so calming compared to before that I can go, no, I know how this works.
Yeah.
And yes, this can be done. And I have a really good option for that. You know, that is just fantastic. And I really believe in us, you know, your life being a journey and you're gaining experience and knowledge. And that is an amazing thing.
Definitely. So just to bring it back to those, I guess, 7 years where you had your daughter, did part of you just enjoy those years and or were you actively seeking work for those 7 years?
Like, oh no, I was actively seeking work. And I mean, I guess I, you know, my kind of creative output is very much part of my mental balance.
Yeah.
So if I don't have that, I'm mentally not very balanced.
Right.
And I had quite bad postnatal depression with both my children. Mm. So that in itself becomes something tricky. So it's not that I didn't enjoy being with them.
Yeah.
But I needed to have a balance. The seeking was, in a way, more urgent than just, I want to work and do something. And
no,
I
understand that.
And earn money. But it was just, you know, I would get things, but it would be really small. And, you know, it's interesting how at the point in your life where you have been given the biggest responsibility mm-hmm. you will ever have, because you're responsible for another human being's life.
Yeah.
The rest of society treats you like your child, like, oh, you can't do that anymore, can you? I mean, how are you going to do that? Mm-hmm. You know, people talking to you in that voice, and I just thought, like, are you crazy? What happened? I mean, have I lost a limb? Do you mean? Why are you talking to me like I can't make my own decisions
anymore?
It's backwards,
isn't it? You've physically grown a human being. Which is astonishing, and people are like...
Yes, it's so patronising. No. And, you know, if anything, and you probably find it with any parents you look at, parents are the most organised people in the world, especially mothers. Do you know what I mean? It's like they will tell you if they can do something or not.
Definitely.
And they will tell you when, and they will tell you how long it will take, and it will definitely be done on that day, and it will be done on that day, because they have no leeway. They just have to do it then. Yeah. And when you're not in a great place, and you get constantly met with those things, it's really difficult to kind of not let yourself, you know, believe that you're not capable. And I actually went off and did something else for a while.
Oh, you did? What
which
did
was
you
just
do?
I set up this company with a friend making products for children.
I love that.
So and it was and the interesting thing was that, you know, I sometimes look back and go, was that a waste of time? Because I invested so much time and effort into it. But the reason why it wasn't is because I needed to go away from that negative place and from those negative attitudes, do something to make myself feel better about myself again. And to go back, and then all of a sudden people went like, oh, what happened? She's all glowing and everything. Yes, because I was doing something again. Do you know what I mean? So even though I stopped that all, because then, you know, theatre took off again. But had I not done that, I'm not sure if I would have really been able to go back.
Well, this is almost a bigger discussion in the industry as a whole, isn't it? Balancing a creative career with mental health.
Yeah.
Because for those who are still kind of working their way up or finding it tricky to find work, you've got this wall you're facing. Yeah. So I mean, from what you've described, it's exactly the same as what you've experienced being a mother in the industry with postnatal. Like it's a very tricky thing to dig yourself out of.
It is. It is.
And say to yourself, it's not me, it's society, it's the industry, which, yes, is a wonderful thing, but at the same time, it can be so cruel.
Oh, absolutely. And first, you have to convince yourself, and then you have to convince everyone else.
So,
and I think the interesting thing, I think generally as a woman, you know, many places, but in this industry, definitely, and then as a parent again, I always felt like I can never, ever fail. I can never make a mistake. I can never fail because all the eyes are watching. Everyone is going like, you know, it's like you have to prove that you can. I had to prove that I can do this profession as a woman, and I had to prove that I can do this profession as a mother.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'd be the first one there, the last one to leave. I would never show a picture of my children. I would never, until my
really,
son
that
was
an active
six,
choice.
Yeah, I would not mention that I had children, would never talk about them at all.
That's heartbreaking.
And it was a male director who I was working with, who has children as well, and he was the first person who I remember. I came in and I said, God, I'm a bit kind of stressed. He said, why? And I said, oh, my son is at home and he's really sick. And he said, what are you doing here? I went, well, you know, we have this meeting. He said, you have a sick child at home, go home. And it was the first time that anyone had said something like that. And it was like, oh my God, I can't believe that. And he was so open. He would always ask me about the kids and how they're doing, whatever. And it's the first time that I felt comfortable in a working one. So
it's
my son was six, so my daughter would have been 10.
That's such a human moment, isn't it?
Yes.
That you just want people to be able to do so easily. But
and now, because I'm a comfortable in where I am, I talk about them a lot, not because I need to, but because I now don't care anymore. Do you know what I mean? And people, I know I'm secure in my job, and I just want it to become normal. You know, I want it to be something that is totally fine.
Yeah.
And anyway, so...
So what was that moment with that director, kind of the breakthrough moment
Definitely.
For you, getting you back into...
He was actually one of the first people as well who looked at my portfolio in equal measures. And I remember going to that meeting and saying to my husband before, should I say that I have children or not? And should I say that my son was quite little when I met him? You know, should I say that, whatever? And I decided not to. And it was his openness in the meeting where I thought, like, I think I can. And that was definitely a turning point. It just gave me the confidence and the kind of all of a sudden also, the, you know, it's crazy what people can talk into your head that you actually feel it is, that it's something somehow shameful that you have children. And I felt really guilty later as well. And just thought, like, why am I hiding them? They're the most important thing in my life. You know, I'm not hiding them anymore. And we shouldn't ask people to hide them.
No,
and there's
100%.
Absolutely no reason why you should not be a mother and work in theatre. I can tell you 100% there is no reason.
Well, exactly. Look at you, you're doing it.
No, exactly.
But you know what, it's so crucial to have discussions like this, because I have no doubt that kind of thing still goes on.
Oh God, absolutely. I mean, I do think it's better, but it does still go on. I think also it's a psychological thing. I think, you know, as we both know, as women, we're still so programmed to many things that where we should actually go, like, hang on a minute.
Oh,
do you know what I mean?
I know.
And somehow it's still there. And I can see, for example, my daughter, that there's some things that I still have to consciously go, oh no, this is not okay. Don't even occur to her anymore. So yes, there are changes.
Yeah.
As in, she just won't even, you know, consider it. Or my son, actually. So no, I think these things are absolutely still going on. I do still meet young female designers who say, oh, do I have to make a decision? And I can't believe I'm still hearing this now, you know.
Yeah.
So no, we're not, I mean, we're nowhere near.
I think it's an element of also just being a freelancer versus someone with, I guess, slightly more job security in a standard role, whatever industry, because you really do have to think about those things.
You do, you know? And I mean, I did several jobs where I earned less than I paid for childcare.
Yeah.
So, you know, if my husband hadn't earned enough, then and wouldn't have been the kind of person who would never for once question whether I should do that job then. Do you know what I mean? Because that's the other thing, that you then meet the question, why are you even going to work? Why are you even doing this if it's not financially profitable to us? And so quite often women are put in that position where unless it's kind of profitable, then you can't do it. But what about you as a person? Do you
know
what I mean?
Well, this is the thing. It's profit does not just mean financial.
No.
You know, it means well-being. It means creativity. It means enjoyment.
Yeah.
It means so much more things than just are you making money out of it?
Definitely.
Which sometimes can be construed in this industry in particular negatively, in terms of people asking you to do free work because it's worth the experience or it's an exciting project,
yes.
It's a double-edged sword, that conversation, but it is. Do you enjoy being a freelancer and in charge of all that, or would you prefer like an in-house role?
No, I do enjoy being a freelancer. I have to very honestly say that, even though I think what has become really clear in the last few months, maybe not, I mean, I've known this for a while, but I think it's really brought it home, is that being a freelancer will need to have more securities in the future. You can't just be a free floating where nobody has any responsibilities towards you. I do think there's something that has to change because, you know, for example, I wouldn't have the option. There aren't, you know, in this country, there aren't kind of fixed jobs in a theatre for a designer. So it's not my choice necessarily. So I guess what I like about being a freelancer is the fact that I go with our workers, and that, like we talked before, I love having new experiences and moving around and working in different groups. So I wouldn't want to change that. But what is difficult is that, you know, in between, you know, I might be working for four theatres at the same time. Whenever you're there, what their interest in you is, that they want you for this, and they want the best out of you. They want to have the maximum out of hours out of you, whatever. They will take whatever they can.
Oh yeah.
You leave the building, you're nothing to them. Do you know what I mean? You walk out, they don't care. Do you know what I mean? So if I would say, I still have 5 hours on this other job to do, they don't even want to hear it. Do you know what I mean? Because that's not meant to be part of me.
Yeah.
I'm only meant to be that little part that they want.
Their resource, and that's that.
Absolutely, which is very disregardful towards, you know, the person. And that doesn't even include, you know, that I have to go home and make dinner or whatever. Mm-hmm. Or what would, if something happens to me, if I got injured, do you know what I mean? That wouldn't really mean anything to anyone other than myself and my family. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And I think there's something wrong in that. And there's something wrong in that in general, but there's also something wrong in that because theatres and productions want everything of you. And you can't want everything of someone. You can't want, everything of somebody and not give anything back.
Right.
I think that's a massive problem that we have in our industry that has to change.
So, I mean, I guess how do we change that? Do we just have more respect for freelancers?
I think
there has
to be more security for freelancers, maybe like you have in the States. I don't see why someone who takes full profit of you should not be responsible in paying into a kind of something that has to do with, you know, what if I get sick or kind of pension or whatever. Do you know what I mean? But I also think there has to be more regulation in kind of, you know, who says I should only earn this? Mm. And, you know, basically the offers we get is this is your fee and you need to be there for this and this and this and this and that amount of time. And you do the numbers and you're literally below living wage.
Right.
And you go, well, how can you? And so my feeling sometimes is, okay, if this is your fee and this is what you're saying you're paying me, you cannot demand for me to be there for every single preview due to me.
Is there no body for people like yourself? Stage designers, costume designers, is there no body to kind of control that pay level?
Not really. I mean, there's, you know, you've got two unions, there's Equity and there's Bec2, and we kind of sit a little bit in between, and neither of them have ever really committed fully to supporting and understanding our roles.
Right.
So they're very kind of massive on actors or whatever,
yes,
and we're just a little sidekick. And because what our profession looks like and the timeline and the jobs could not be more different to an actor.
Mm-hmm.
So unless you really know what that is, you can't be that helpful.
Right.
But then also, you know, the different bodies within theatre in this country kind of set those rates. There is really not enough of a kind of looking into why they are what they are.
Mm.
And quite often these bodies like Equity, whatever, agree to things that really shouldn't be agreed to.
Right.
So actually my biggest support is my agent. So I'm lucky that I have a very brilliant agent.
So at the beginning of lockdown and when all these, I guess, changes started happening with the COVID virus, you and I guess some of your friends in the industry started this collective, let's call it, Scene Change.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. I mean, it was probably quite a few weeks into lockdown. So obviously for all of us, work stopped from one day to the next.
Yes.
Internationally, as in, you know, actually it was first New York for me that stopped, and then Austria, and then England. And so, you know, we were unemployed from one day to the next. It really means no work at all and no income at all. And I think about, I don't know, it must have been 5 or 6 weeks into lockdown, one designer sent an email out to a few other designers she knew, and just, I think it was entitled Conversation in Strange Times. and she literally just said, I'm really lonely.
Yeah.
And I really miss everyone. And, you know, none of us, like, I've known her for years, but not massively, do you know what I mean? Not very closely.
Yeah.
And so she just said, would anyone be interested to just have a Zoom?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And so there was a small group of us who said yes. And I maybe knew two other people out of that group. The thing with designers is that we never work together because there's only ever one designer. I mean, sometimes, so I just did a show where I did costume and someone else did set, and it's the first time in a long time that I worked closely with another designer, and I really loved it.
Yeah.
So it was funny because we had this group of people who kind of do the same, and are a bit awkward because anyway, but it was like literally that one Zoom was like electric thing. Apart from the fact that I think for years within the industry and as designers, we've known that we needed to get galvanized a bit more because there's so many issues, so many things that are difficult, and there's never really been a place for us to discuss that, especially not a place for people who are really in the middle of their career.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of, you know, helping, you know, younger designers, but actually you get to a certain point and there's not really that support there.
You're like, hello, I still exist.
Exactly, and I do also have questions.
Yeah.
And I could really do with
just
chatting about these things sometimes. And for years with some of them, we've been saying, oh, we really should. And then obviously the thing is that we're all so busy.
Yeah,
you know, we're so busy,
happen.
We have different places, and so we can't, anyway. So I think the two things collided, as in a kind of like a history of a need to kind of meet more and kind of formally unite, with obviously the kind of loneliness of lockdown, with also I think the kind of obviously desperation of the industry and the knowledge that, you know, sadly all of us, even though we love what we do and we love the industry and we love you know, working in the places we work, and not very happy with the conditions, you know, and kind of knowing that there is quite a big element of exploitation. You committing in a way that you shouldn't. I mean, I feel very guilty quite often towards my children, because it's one thing if you say, I have to go to work and I cannot be at your school play. Because you actually, you know, there is a really important meeting and you do actually get money properly. Then to say that and go, but what for? Just to do someone else a favor who wouldn't think about me twice once I walk out of the door. And then all of a sudden the question becomes bigger, doesn't it? Where you go, what am I sacrificing these things for?
Yeah, it is just a bit of an expectation really though, isn't it? Like, you're expected to be exploited.
Exactly. And then you get kind of, you know, to my age and you go, I don't really want that anymore, and I don't agree with it. Do you know what I mean? And it doesn't make you feel good about yourself. And actually, you know, also you become far more clear about your value. I know what I bring to things. Do you know what I mean? And I'm really clear on that. And I know that the other, you know, the other side knows what I bring to it.
So was it quite hard learning to say no?
It was. I mean, yes, but it's just purely, I guess, but again, more out of a power structure, as in what obviously, you know, generally is the method is kind of, you know, we are needy, as in we, you know, as you get along, you you kind of want to build a career, you need work and you need money, and you want to be you don't want to be not liked because you need the next job, but you know, that's how exploitation works, however. And so what is really liberating is to get to a place where you go, no, I'm not just going to sell myself like that anymore. Do you know what I mean? I'm not. And I'm not that worried about burden. And I'm not worried to say no to something that isn't okay. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you obviously have to get to a place where you you are clear of your value, I guess. And so, yes, so scene change kind of was then kind of, so we started meeting, we literally just from that one meeting we said, shall we meet again? And then it was very, very quick that we really galvanized and meant and kind of I think as designers, the interesting thing is that compared to a lot of other creative professions within, you know, the creative team, we work with a lot of people. We actually have huge responsibilities for a lot of other departments.
Right.
And so our we counted it during lockdown. So if you have a design, you're potentially employing 38 other professions. So if, for example, in lockdown, people start going, oh, maybe we just don't have designs anymore on stage to cut costs. That's not just a designer not working. That is a dyer not working, that's a set builder not working, that's a scenic artist not working, that's a prop maker not working, that's a pattern cutter not working, that's a dressmaker not, do you know what I mean? So
that's
38 professions, you know, wigs and hair, makeup, prosthetics, special effects,
all lead back
automations, do you know what I mean? I mean, that's all, and these, you know, these are all very skillful crafts, you know, professions, really, really skillful.
Also, it's also theatre.
It is.
Like, I mean, if all you've got is a stage and an actor.
Yes.
I mean, yes, there are shows like that, but they're boring.
But the interesting thing is that people love kind of talking about, you know, Peterborough kind of black box or whatever. That was a designer.
Yeah.
That was a designer's idea who designed it and developed it. You know, that wasn't just a no set question. And it wasn't the director's idea either. Yes. And so I think what the first instance of what we did was setting up these kind of, you know, Zooms to speak to all the different professions in order to kind of just have a place for people to communicate and to help with the kind of, you know, mental health and loneliness. And that was fascinating, just because we've learned so much about the different professions. Some of them, for example, who never had unions or associations before, started forming because of these Zooms. So in the Zoom, all of a sudden, they all meet and they go, we have these problems, we need to talk to each other. And then they would go off and form a group. And we had quite a lot of international Zooms, which was fascinating, just hearing how, I mean, literally from India to America, yeah. You know, I mean...
And is, do you find similar issues are popping up yeah, in different countries?
Yes, and yeah, absolutely. And then sometimes quite different, but then the difference is really good to see. Do you mm. mean someone, something that we found really, really hard, you know, the Americans would go, that is nothing compared to where we are at. Do you right. mean? So quite interesting. Then that makes you a little bit more go like, okay, well, maybe I should be thankful for what it is and concentrate on something else.
But I guess it, I guess in that instance, it also gives the Americans an example of it does, what they could strive for.
Yes.
And vice versa with yes. other things.
Yeah. And then obviously we did... I don't know if you saw the kind of tape installations mm. that we did on theatre. So that was very much a kind of more or less a gift from us to the theatre. But it was all about yeah. just these empty buildings and yeah. kind of trying to make the public aware as well of what's going on. And I think one of the things that has really come out as a big problem for theatre and why we get so little sympathy and understanding, I think, in the public, because it's quite hard to be out of work, really worried about not knowing where money comes from, mm-hmm. you know, having two children at home, and then people around you going, you're not actually necessary. We don't need. Yeah, well, you're just playing a bit anyway. So why should I be sad about you not having a job? Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's like. It's the same, you know, I need to feed my children the same as anyone else yeah. does. So that's just on a very basic level, I mean, I guess.
It's astonishing almost, that lack of sympathy, considering it is. How many people turn to forms of entertainment yeah. in general over lockdown and
yeah.
COVID. Like, that stemmed from theatre.
Oh my God, you know, Netflix, I think Netflix actually supported one of the...
They did, yeah.
Yeah, because you know, Samantha said exactly that, as, you know, yeah. half of these shows and half of the actors and anyone, you know, all the talent, and that wouldn't exist if it wasn't for theatre
exactly.
training them up.
It's a very easy thing to dismiss
yes.
as unnecessary, but yeah. especially, like, I mean, growing up in England and doing an English lit degree and stuff, British theatre is so integral to it who is. We are as a country.
Well, I mean, you just need to look at the West End now. Yeah. It's dead. And people are really worried because, yeah. you know, the nightclubs, the restaurants, the taxis, none of them can exist in the same way ever yeah. again if theatre wouldn't be there.
Exactly, they all feed off of it.
So, but it's strange, isn't that? That kind of, I think already the kind of thought of what makes you dismiss another human being. I don't really, I mean, I don't eat meat, for example. So I could say, well, what's the point of a butcher?
Yeah.
You know, I don't get it at yeah. all. Like, they're not necessary.
Yeah.
I'm still able to have empathy and to understand another human being's need. Do you yeah. know what I mean? I would never say that. Yeah. It's very strange. But I think one of the problems we have in theatre is that we have this kind of weird thing of going, you know, where the you've got the curtain and everything behind it is secretive.
Mm.
And because it's secretive, people don't know about
yeah.
it. And so that's why people don't know what a hair and makeup person really does
yeah.
or a stage manager really does.
A flyer.
I think people would be fascinated. I think a lot of young people would see far more opportunities in professions in
yeah.
theatre if they knew what they were. Because,
exactly.
you know, if you think about it, that you could become a carpenter and think, okay, well, it's a bit boring, I might just do cabinets. You could also become a theatre or film set builder, which
yeah.
is really exciting. But most people don't know that a carpenter is that.
Exactly.
That's carpenters, or that's a
it's
welder. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or, you know...
It's almost like we want to invite people in to the theatre industry and see it for what it is.
Yes.
You know, it's like when you're in it and you know all the ins and outs and you know the lingo and all of that.
Mm.
But it is, it's almost like a little secret society, isn't it?
It is.
And if people don't know about it, they don't want to know
no,
about it.
No, and then
you know?
It's difficult to have sympathy. So I think it's something we really, that's why we're hitting quite a lot of problems
yeah.
now. And so I guess with Scene Change, we've been thinking a lot about how, you know, how we can reach people and how we can maybe change the perception. So there are
mm.
many different kind of ideas in our heads. And then I guess as designers, so that's one thing. It's like, you know, more of a general thing. But then the other thing also is that interestingly enough, within the industry, hardly anyone knows what we do as designers. It is incredible. Even people you've worked with for years don't, not really, you know, especially not the bit that I do here.
Yeah.
It's because it's, that's why we get paid so badly, because what we do here, nobody sees how many hours that is. So you can just put a bit of a price on it.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Other people, professions that come in and sit down and they're on their computer and they're doing it, whatever, they go like, wow, I can see what they're doing and it looks really hard and I don't understand that program they're working on, whatever. So, you know, surely that must cost something.
Yeah.
And
whereas, like, if they were here looking at your 3D printers and seeing you saw out little miniature things, they'd be like, oh.
Absolutely, completely and utterly. So I think there's another thing about just raising the profile of the profession, which I think is needed in order to protect our ideas more, because our ideas quite often get kind of transferred to someone else's name. So that's one really important thing. And the other thing is pay. You know, if you don't really see what someone does, then it's easy to not pay them properly. So I think that's another thing that we want to do with Scene Change, is just really highlight the profession a bit more.
Right.
And work on diversity, for example, because it's you know, British theatre or theatre in general is not diverse enough, and design really isn't.
And does it favour men?
No, I think it used to. I think that's actually quite levelled now. No, it's too white.
Yeah.
Not many people of different backgrounds come through. And I think the problem is kind of before university. I think that the problem is that so many people don't realise that there are professions in in the industry, and the bad pay, of course. Do you know what I mean? It's like you either you have to be privileged, or you have to work other jobs at the same time, whatever, or you can't do it. So I think these things have to change. That's why pay has to get better as well, in order to open it up. And we're kind of hoping to work more with sometimes even primary school, but definitely secondary school, to just go and speak to people of that age and just kind of bring in an interest.
Yeah, and just go, well, so this is what we do, and it is so an option.
Exactly,
you know?
Yeah. So there's a lot of work to be done there, we all know.
Well,
that
it sounds very exciting, and fingers crossed that we can get the message out far and wide, you know?
Yes,
definitely. So as you're kind of talking about your career as a stage designer is connected to so many others, from what you've said so far, like, a lot of your job is managing a lot of people. So as part of your process, you are connecting with different people every day. You've got set builders, you've got design,
costume makers,
all of that. Is it you who brings them on board? Is it your network, or do other people?
It's a mixture. I mean, the longer you work, the more you obviously build up certain relationships. And so there are definitely people who, and I've got an associate, for example, who I've worked with for many years, you know, who works here with me and on different shows. And I have a few costume supervisors. So the costume supervisor is the person who kind of translate what I draw.
Right.
So they overtake the entire managing of the making of the costumes. Mm-hmm. And that's a very personal relationship.
Yeah.
And so I have a couple of people I totally love, and I will take them everywhere. So unless there's someone in house, I can take them. Production managers, again, who kind of organize the entire make, in a way, you know, if I can, I would work with them. Other creatives, you know, quite often I'm asked which lighting designer I would want to work with. So yes, you kind of, and even makers, you know, for costume, for example, my supervisor will go, okay, well, you have this dress here, don't you think so-and-so would be good to make that? And you've got so-and-so many men's, you know, what about this tailor? And so the more, you know, so I can go like, yeah, I think they're that's totally down there, kind of. Or sometimes you might think of someone. So on one hand, it's brilliant when the more you get to know people, and you can kind of, it's like a library, you know, of people and skills.
Get through your Rolodex.
Yes, and I love that as well, and it's lovely to see people again. It's really nice that when people do a good job for you, that you can keep, you know, going back to them. I think there is so much about, I feel so thankful to all these amazing craftspeople who make what I design brilliant, that if you can go back to them and keep giving them work, that's really fantastic. And then obviously a lot you get suggested, you know, that you haven't worked with before, and that's how I guess you build up your library.
So I mean, I take it so far that managing people is actually quite a large part.
It's a massive part. I think it's 50%. So I would say, you know, talent, you can't get around that.
See, this is why I can never be a stage designer. I can barely draw a stick man. It's not going to happen.
Not necessarily the drawing, actually. There's lots of different ways of doing it. But I do think it's just so highly competitive. Yeah. You know, I do think that isn't necessary, sadly. I think stamina, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And you have to be okay with the lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You know, if that's... When I go and talk in schools... is always one of the main things I say to people, and sometimes teachers look at me a bit like, what's she saying?
Yeah.
But I think I always say, look at what the everyday life is of that of a profession that you're interested in, and then think if you can live that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? That's really important. So I think that's an important thing. And then I definitely think people skills, diplomacy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's that 50% of what I do is negotiate all the time and navigate different characters, different people, different skills, different, you know, set builders are very different kind of person to a dressmaker.
Yeah.
You know, and so on. So actors are very different creatures. The dancers, for example, or opera singers, do you know what I mean? So you can design whatever you want. If you're not able to translate it and to kind of make people understand why it is you want it like this and really get the best out of them. I really believe in, if you want to get the best out of people, you need to let them own it somehow. You need to really... appreciate their skill and ask, you know, make them feel like, firstly, you need to appreciate what they do for you. Secondly, you need to give them space to put their own kind of heart and their own skill into it.
Yeah.
And that is how you get the best out of people.
Yeah.
Because they will be happy. They will want to do the best they can possibly do.
Yeah.
If you're a bully, people only ever just do the minimum for you.
Oh, goodness.
They'll do whatever they need to do in order to not be shouted at. Do you know what I mean? So I think it's the most idiotic principle, you know, you can possibly have.
No, definitely. Would you, I guess, be able to summarise some of the most important lessons you've learned along the way?
Most important lessons. Yes, I mean, that's definitely one of them, as in, you know, treat people well. Also, you will meet them again and you will, you know...
treat them badly, you will come back to bite you.
From them again, I know. Also, it's so nice to have a good time with people, you know. And this is, again, you know, as a freelancer, you're kind of... The whole point of it is that you're creating your work environment. So create something you want to... You need to create what you want to meet every morning.
Exactly.
That's what you need to create.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, I do think learn as much as you can along the way. I always think that, you know, assisting, and again, that's something we're fighting for with Scene Change, is that there will be more, hopefully more money in the future for assistants and associates. I think learning your craft is a really important thing, and learning from other people is a really brilliant thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it never stops, and you should never feel like you're less of a designer if you're still learning. I mean, you know, like I said, when I sometimes am able to share, you know, set and costume with someone else, one of the most amazing things about it is that I'm learning from the other person.
Yeah.
I still learn now from other people, and
every
time you learn something, it's like, well, you gain, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, everyone's got a different view of things.
Yes. I think you should not shirt the journey.
Yeah.
I think it's really important, and it's really, it is a totally different thing to get somewhere and know that you've earned it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I had my first kind of nominations for anything, and I never thought that I would be nominated for anything.
Yeah.
I think the best thing about those moments was that I felt like I knew I'd earned it. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't something where you go like, oh, that's really nice, but I feel a bit cheeky.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Because I haven't really done anything. It was really nice to go, no, that's okay, actually. And therefore I can accept it and I can be proud of it and I don't have to be shamed and I don't have to, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I can just really,
so, enjoy it. Yeah.
Yes.
No, 100%. I think, so... Would that be the thing that you say to someone starting out? Just appreciate the lessons and the experience you get along the way.
Yes, you know? Definitely. And meet people. You know, I know it's so difficult to break into it. But you should just, I mean, you know, seeing things and then writing to someone because you liked what they've done. Is it, you know, that personal touch is always quite important. And you do, again, stamina does come into it there as well, is because you will need it later. Like, you know, someone like me, if I have people send me emails and saying they want to assist or whatever, you know, of course there are a lot. And so you know that you have to kind of choose and make sure that there really is the interest there.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell very quickly if someone just wants to have the fast journey. And as much, for example, as I don't think is right that we work very long hours or whatever, we should be working like everyone else. Mm-hmm. But the reality is that that will happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are people who kind of come from, like, I'm going to be there from 10 to 4, and there are people who are just there. And they might never be there for longer than 4. But in their mindset, they're there because a job needs to be done and they'll do it. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's a mindset thing. So I'm not saying I'm asking people to work long hours at all. It's just you can sense whether that mindset is there. Yeah.
There needs to be a love for what you're doing.
There needs to be a love. And then, and you know, and the people who've worked with me the longest, there's one associate I had for many years, and she's now doing amazing stuff on her own and us together, actually, which is very nice.
Good.
And she was so persistent. You know, she wrote a few times and then she came to say hello in the studio, and I had many people work with me in no space whatsoever.
Yeah.
And she said, but can I just come?
Can I just sit?
Can I just come and just be there?
Yeah.
And it's literally how she willed her way into it. You know, it's like, I couldn't say no to someone just wanting to come. I said, but I feel really shit because I haven't got money. I'm spending more money on these other people. And I would obviously, I'm pretty sure, paid for her journey. I always made her lunch. Never had to eat, you know, buy any food or whatever. It's like, that's the only thing I could do. And then, of course, you kind of like fall in love with someone. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And they're brilliant and they're dedicated. And we worked together for years. But it's that dedication. Do you know what I mean? It's the kind of really putting. So if you want it, you need to work on it.
Definitely. Well, there we go then. Advice for pretty much every element of a career.
Sorry, it was long.
No, we love it. We love it. And thank you so much for your time and your insight. I'm sure there'll be many people out there who are very appreciative, myself included.
No, I loved it.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Good Bad Mad podcast. Please subscribe to check out the next episode or leave a review if you liked it. You can find us on Instagram at GoodBadMad or at GoodBadMad.com for additional resources and information. See you next time!